Now that you've found UBN Radio and discovered our quality talk shows, it's time to spread the word to friends, family, and the universe. 24 hours of music and talk. Radio without limits. That's why people keep coming back for more. That's UBNRadio.com.
Jump off that exhausting hamster wheel and into balanced living
with Dr. Marissa.
Promise you joy in the mystery.
Dr. Marissa, also known as the Asian Oprah. Her mission, to be a beneficial presence on the planet. Her purpose, to be your personal advocate to live, laugh, love, learn. Her life motto, don't die wondering. Take back your life with Dr. Marissa Payne.
And welcome. You are tuned into my weekly talk radio show called Take My Advice. I'm not using it. Get balanced with Dr. Marissa every Tuesday at Naturally High Noon here out of the Sunset Gower Studios Universal Broadcasting Network. And then again every Thursday and Saturday on my syndicated CNBC News Radio channel KCAA AM 1050 and FM 102.3, FM 106.5, and then now everywhere iHeartRadio is, just Google my name, and you'll find me because I'm here to splatter hope and happiness, no matter what you are watching on TV. Because on this show, there's no gossip, no scandal, no K-words, no Kardashian talk at all. In fact, there's probably no tea talk now either. We know what that stands for, because I want you to focus on your own reality show, what you can control, and how to be happy 88% of the time. And yes, this Saturday is Chinese New Year. And if you didn't know yet, you still thought I was Swedish. I am actually Chinese. So I'm going to teach you a little bit of Chinese for the occasion. So if you say Xin Nian Kuai Le, that means Happy New Year, and happiness. So, Xin Nian Kuai Le. Now, you got to be really careful of the intonation, which makes Chinese one of the most difficult languages to speak. That because if you say Xi Nian Kuai Le, which sounds very similar, you're saying wash your face quickly. So, Xin Nian Kuai Le, and it is the year of the rooster. And that is on Saturday, Lunar New Year. So, Xin Nian Kuai Le, and from Dr. Marissa. And as per usual, as I start the show with some peace shout outs to fabulous people that I've met this week, Meg and Sherry, who took care of me in the emergency room. If you've been following my Facebook, I was at Los Alamitos Medical Center for an x-ray because, yeah, I fell down the stairs and landed straight on my ankle. And it was not fun. But thank God my daughters were home and they rushed me there. I've been under house rest and I was following doctor's orders for 48 hours. So it's much better. And I'm here just hobbling on one crutch, but no broken bones, just a bruised ego and ligaments. But very, very happy to be able to come and do the show. Another shout out to Josh and his fellow fabulous performers at Drumline Live. I had no idea how timely its message of celebrating and tracing the history of the Black University Marching Pride after the Civil War. The show was great, very fitting for the day after the inauguration and the day of the Women's March. And one more time, for those of you who haven't heard me, being very clear that I believe that we need to, yes, stand up for human rights and dignity, but if we use the same hate that we're complaining about, we kind of miss the point. So I'm hoping that in the days to come that we really get that distinction. Otherwise, there will be no peaceful transfer of power. And let's see, one more thing. Very helpful show I wanted to bring on today, someone who I get a lot of questions actually on, you know, how do you publish your book? Because I've been fortunate to publish a few, and I know that everyone absolutely has a story in them. So I wanted to bring on Karen Stuth, who is the co-founder and co-owner of Satyama, a small but robust publishing company specializing in mind, body, spirit, and conscious living titles and products. She's edited more than 25 books and brought forward from manuscript to bestseller a number of category-leading titles, including How Trees Got Their Voices by Susan Andra Lyon and Children's Spirit Animal Cards by Dr. Stephen Farmer, both multiple award-winning top sellers in their market. She's a recognized expert in the publishing process, having successfully mentored a number of young writers, and is well known for her marketing skills in bringing forward these titles to public recognition on a small budget. Without further ado, please welcome to the studio, Karen Stuth. Hi, Karen.
Hello there.
Welcome to the show, and I'm so glad the circuitous way that we made a connection was actually through your friend Lori, or one of your authors, right? Julie. Yeah. No, is it Julie or Lori?
It was Julie Lohr.
It was Julie Lohr. I was close. Yeah. And I actually met her when I was on tour with the Agape Choir in Peru, of all places. And she came and was participating in our rehearsals. And she gave me her card. I gave her mine. And next thing I know, I have a fabulous guest that has all the answers that anyone who's ever wanted to publish a book has. So welcome.
Thank you so much. I'm delighted to be here.
Yes. And where are you calling in from so people can know?
I live in southern Colorado, where we're having a bit of snow today. It's really quite lovely out there. I live south of Denver, right up next to the mountains.
Beautiful. Beautiful. So let's go to the topic of writing a book. So I am an average person who feels led to write a book, and it has definitely changed. I think in the old days, I believe, if you said I'm a writer or a published writer, that was few and far between. And we would have book clubs, and these writers would have best-selling books because a publisher picked them up. And then Oprah helped a lot by having her own book club and brought authors that she liked into sort of notoriety. But publishing a book was not something that anyone could do. Is that about right?
That is about right. In the old days, or the time before self-publishing became so accessible to anyone and everyone, the process was that you would get a literary agent,
yep,
or maybe try to go it alone, and you would send your book prospectus off to one of the big publishing houses, and it would land, on a desk. When I say desk, I mean it would land somewhere in a department where, editorial people would take a look at the prospectus and, they'd give a quick pass on it, yes, no. And
yes.
They were looking for properties that were, pretty much sure things that, maybe they followed a formula or were of, a topic or something about them that made that publishing house particularly interested in that.
Mm-hmm.
And working through a literary agent, someone had already sort of made a pass on whether the manuscript was worth, having a look at in the first place. So a lot of people who had very, very worthy books out there really never, they never got a chance because,
right,
such a fast process. And, among the authors who had a hard time getting their book published in the first place was, the guy who wrote Lord of the Flies, William Golding, and also John le Carré with his book The Spy Who Came in from the Cold, and Margaret Mitchell, who wrote Gone with the Wind, and William Faulkner with Sanctuary. The Diary of Anne Frank, that's another that was rejected and rejected and rejected 15 times.
Mm, wow.
And most people have seen that Beatrix Potter movie, where she ended up publishing The Tale of Peter Rabbit herself. Stephen King's novel Carrie was rejected 30 times. J.K. Rowling's first book was rejected. I've heard different numbers about how many times, mm-hmm, the first Harry Potter book was rejected. Louisa May Alcott was told to stick to teaching when she submitted Little Women.
Wow.
So, Marcel Proust had to pay for his own publication of Remembrance of Things Past. So, you know, a lot of people have been rejected by some of the big publishing houses. But with the advent of, you know, digital technology and print on demand, a lot of people began to publish their own books. So the number of new books has grown from about 200,000 a year to close to a million.
Wow.
And that's both good and bad.
Okay. Now is that 2 million regular publishers plus the self-publishing or still just regular publishers?
It's close to a million books a year that are coming out through North American-based publishers.
Okay.
There are only a few publishing houses left. I believe there's still the big three standing, but I haven't looked lately to see who's acquired who.
Right.
It's literally happening on a daily basis.
Wow.
The big publishing houses are buying up the little ones. So.
Okay. So I guess the great news is the expertise in picking books that will be bestsellers is now not limited to those large publishing houses. I mean, music's done the same thing with YouTube. People are realizing they don't need someone else to sort of validate their talent, that if they can present it in a way that like everybody has a following somewhere. So that if it's true for their music, it's true for books too. That's what.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
That is absolutely true. That people are bypassing going through a big record label or a publishing house and bringing forward their own books. And you know, many of them meeting great success if they're doing it correctly.
Mm-hmm.
There are, you know, many self-published books out there that aren't doing very well because people don't really know what to do once they get the book written.
Right. And that's why I brought you on. Because that then the shift from everyone being able to access, okay, I want to be a published author, and then that goes to the other extreme now where you think that the only thing you need is just to write the book and blindly trusting people who say, I will help you publish your book, but not realizing what exactly that entails. So I've heard horror stories of people who've spent thousands or tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of dollars creating, writing, and producing books that sit in their basement on top of the, you know, the exercise equipment that also is not used. So there's boxes of books in the basement that they've spent money on, but because they also do not understand the publishing process, it's almost like it's a blessing that is still disguised. How's that?
That is an excellent synopsis of the situation. But the person that printed 5,000 to 10,000 copies and they're sitting in their basement, you know, all is not lost for them. You know, they can still, you know, obtain an expert to help them market and get the book out there. So, you know, that person is not, you know, completely out of luck, but the scenario that you just described pushes a lot of people toward print on demand, which I personally am not a fan of for just a number of reasons.
Okay.
And generally, we do not take clients at Satyama Writers Resource that come to us with a print on demand book.
Okay.
Because there's very little that we can do with it or do about it at that point.
Okay.
That generally the people are then stuck with the contract they signed with a print-on-demand publisher. And print-on-demand publishers are actually printers. For the most part, they're generally printers and not actually publishers. So it's still up to the author to do all the marketing unless he goes out and gets some assistance. And I want to mention that even the big publishing houses these days won't really get a book that doesn't come with a marketing proposal as well. So you know, the book or a summary of the book or an excerpt of the book is submitted, along with a marketing plan, which shows how much money the author out of their own pocket is going to spend promoting the book that the big publishing house might, you know, publish for them. They'll do some marketing on their own, but they look to the authors more and more to do the lion's share of the work. Because a large publisher may have accepted your book doesn't mean that you're not going to be out there working extremely hard and using your own money to set up book tours and all kinds of things like that. So okay. It's not the way that it looks in the movies.
Right, right. So let's backtrack a bit. And if you've just tuned in and you're wondering who I'm talking to today, it is the owner of Satyama Writers Resource and Satyama Publishing House, who is Karen Stuth, and I brought her on to sort of help us through the jungle of self-publishing, since the landscape has changed and we're talking about print-on-demand. So let's, before we talk about, because I think some people don't know what print-on-demand is, including myself. So let me give you a scenario. Actually, let me use myself. All right. So my next book that's coming out is called Take My Advice. I Am Using It. Get Balanced with Dr. Marissa. And I know that this is a book that people need to hear. So I have written probably 5 out of the 8 chapters. Okay. So I come to you and I say, Karen, what should I do now? And what's the first thing you're going to tell me?
Well, the first thing I'm going to do is look at what's been written so far so I can kind of get a feel for, you know, where you're at with your book and what kind of book it is and whether I think it's marketable. And I want to be clear that not every book is marketable. Many books are marketable, and I think it's important for people to write their story for a number of reasons, but not all books are marketable. They may have this problem or that problem, or the slant is not interesting. So the first thing I'm going to do is take a look at the marketability.
Okay. Give me two examples of something that's marketable and two examples of something that is not marketable.
We are presented with so many manuscripts all the time. The ones that I feel are marketable have a unique way of perhaps revisiting an old theme. The theme might be, you know, I was, you know, sick in my soul and my body, and then, you know, I became well by doing this or that. You know, that is always a marketable topic because there's something about that story that's going to help somebody out there, and they're really going to latch onto it.
Perfect.
And, you know, if the book is written well, then it will be marketable. But somebody that just wants to write their story, and they write their story so that we're reading about, well, on this day I went to the grocery store, and then I filled my car with gas, and then I came home and I watered the petunias, is not a marketable book. It doesn't really tell that person's story in a way that makes it interesting or compelling or makes us care.
Right.
So that's a
really good measure. Does it make you care? So I'm trying to get to the sort of the measuring sticks that you use to assess what those manuscripts, if they're marketable or not. So if you read it and you go, I care, or I'm drawn in to care, then you would say that's marketable. Perfect.
And recently someone submitted a manuscript to me, which we actually are going forward with, you know, through Satyama Writers Resource, which is a division of Satyama Publishing. So Satyama Publishing is our parent organization, and we have this division, Satyama Writers Resource, that helps self-published authors, because as Satyama Publishing, we just can't publish them all. But I never intended to start Satyama Writers Resource, but people were calling me on the phone. I was found that I was spending hours and hours with them, talking them through what to do. And, you know, finally I just said, I'm going to get organized.
And nothing like a show date to help with that.
Yes. And Satyama Writers Resource was born. And I have to say that, you know, it's a thing that I feel passionate about. You know, sometimes I'm so excited about the work we're doing, I can hardly sleep.
Yeah.
That I'm, you know, generally don't take on projects through either part of our company that I don't feel that way about.
Yeah, and that's the beautiful thing, because that's your gift. Because this is why I wanted to bring you on, because people don't understand that just because you have a story or just because you have something that you think is really fabulous, it's not enough. There's so many facets to publishing a book well that nobody teaches you that. You don't go to a course, or you can, you know, look it up on the internet, or you can read, you know, what a large company tells you what you need to do to get published, and then here's the money that they want in order to do that. So
well, one of the things that we never do is take away the writer's voice. So even in our editing process and working with them, we have great respect for the author's voice, and we might recommend this or that, you know, mm-hmm. to the storyline or to the chapter or the way they're telling their story. But at all times, we're seeking to keep the author's voice there. And I started to say that I was recently going through a manuscript that was submitted to us. And when I looked at the title on the page, and I immediately didn't like it, because I didn't like the title. It didn't draw me in. And I knew that anybody just picking up a book called that would not buy it. Mm-hmm. But I did want to read a little bit of it, so I made a cup of tea and I sat down and I said, I'm just going to read the first 5 pages. And then an hour later, I'd read the first 35 pages, and I actually didn't stop until I finished it, and loved it so much.
Oh, great. So it was just the title.
But it's, you know, even the title, you know, is a very important thing that you'll want to get some input on. People generally are not good at picking titles for their book that, you know, are ultimately going to get them that shelf space in that bookstore.
Yeah. Yeah. My first book.
One of the reasons. I'm sorry. Please go ahead.
Yeah, sorry. My first book that was published by Josie Bass is called Organization Development Foundations and Perspectives. Not very tantalizing, but it's okay. It's a business text at university, so I'm happy with that. But anyways, go ahead. I'm sorry. So let's.
Well,
go,
I was just.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say our book, which is, you know, was a runaway bestseller called How the Trees Got Their Voices, which actually was brought out by Satyama Publishing. The title alone draws people in. When I talk to people on the phone who don't have a copy of the book or haven't seen the book. And I say it's called How the Trees Got Their Voices, the book I'm calling about today. And they instantly want to know more because of the title of the book. So
yes.
That's one of those elements of marketability that I'm referring to.
And I'm actually holding it up. You can't see me, but I'm holding up the book right now. And, actually, this is a coloring book version. So there's a book and a coloring book version.
There's a book and a coloring
book. Oh, here
it is. Yes.
Okay, here's the hard cover. Oh, that's really pretty. So next step, you let's just assume that you like my book or you like my chapters, and you say, okay, this is marketable, and then you give me the revisions and you tell me what to do. What's the next step after that?
Well, generally, I encourage people while we're going out for printing prices, you know, one of the things we do is we gather up a lot of printing bids for the author and go through them, you know, with the author to discuss, you know, what they have budget for, what they don't have budget for. But that invokes the next step, which is crowdfunding. We are one of the only publishing consultancies to offer assistance with crowdfunding, which I consider to be a crucial step for every author. Whether you have, let's say your garage has, you know, big sacks of money in it and you don't even know how to spend it all. But
I'm coming,
you know,
there.
but it's a great visual. But,
yes.
So we still encourage people to do a crowdfunding program because it is such an exceptional way to launch a book.
Absolutely.
And you get a lot of free publicity. You know, I prefer the crowdfunding platform called Indiegogo, but there are many good ones out there. I like mm-hmm. Indiegogo because you don't have to hit your goal to get the money.
Mm-hmm.
That is, you know, pretty essential for everyone who's running a crowdfunding program. But through crowdfunding, what you're doing is you're pre-selling the book. You're not asking people to give me money so I can just go and, you know, use it. You're pre-selling copies of your book. Generally, they're signed copies. They, you know, maybe you'll get your name in the acknowledgments. You know, perhaps, you know, a character will be named after you. There's a lot of different ways that authors incent people to pre-purchase their book or fund their fund the book itself. But, you know, through these big crowdfunding websites, you know, we're talking about tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of people every day that come and just scroll through the campaigns. And these people are learning about your book before it's even been launched.
Right.
And they become curious. And we have many, many, many people that run crowdfunding programs that have donations from people that they just have no idea who they are.
Right.
But they want a copy of that book. And I think it's very, very important because crowdfunding essentially costs very little to nothing to do. As long as you have, you know, a good email list of your own, you have, you know, a pretty big crowd, you know, through friends, family, colleagues that you work with, neighbors, your church, whatever, you know, you're going to be successful with your crowdfunding program, you know, some more successful than others. But it's very important to be able to do that. And also, this is where, you know, writers learn to become our authors. They learn to be able to talk about their book and describe it and start to believe in it. And I've seen people just really shift through the crowdfunding process. So it's very exciting.
Right.
Very exciting.
So they're validating themselves in the process. Yeah. So give me a range of what you would say. So someone who wants to start this little journey called publishing my own book, at the very least, sort of bare bones, what the expectation is in order to get the book from start to finish, and then sort of the average, what you're seeing, and the top end. Just to, I know that's a hard thing to ask you to do, but just so that my listeners kind of know, you know, it is an investment. This is a product. This is a business, really. You know, writing your own book is a business.
Well, authors need to approach their authors and writers need to approach their books as, you know, business ventures. I know that they are very emotionally tied to them, but they need to remember that, you know, publishing is a business and it has all these arms and legs to it. You know, you need to, you know, hire an editor. Sometimes the book needs, you know, substantial illustration. If it's a children's storybook, you know, the illustrations are as important as the story. And, you know, you need to get the book printed. You know, you're going to have to house it somewhere unless you hire us to do that. We do storage and distribution is one of the things we also offer. You need money for marketing the book, you know, just to get it out there. And not only to buy advertising, but to enter award programs and maybe to send yourself on a little book tour or all kinds of different things. You know, there are 100 ways to market a book. What does that cost? It just so depends on so many things. You know, how much the book is going to cost to be printed is one of the major factors. You know, if you're doing print on demand, you don't have to worry too much about investing in the production part because you're paying someone to print them one at a time.
Right.
But as I mentioned, I'm not a fan of on-demand. I always encourage people to consider other alternatives because print-on-demand handcuffs the author most often that they don't even understand. So,
is it possible to print a book for under $5,000? Like for the whole? Okay, so 2,000.
No, so it depends on quantity.
I'm sorry, I'm Chinese. I'm trying to get to the number.
you know, it's hard for me to generate that because, you know, a children's picture book that's 32 pages, let's say hardcover with a dust jacket, you know, wouldn't it be difficult to get that printed on really beautiful paper? And I am talking hardback with a dust jacket for around, you know, between $1.50 and $2 a unit. If they're willing to print 2,500, that's usually where the price break is. It's about 2,500. For all the other things that I'm talking about, again, it really depends on the book and how hard we're going to have to work to build a fire underneath it that can be seen all the way from like Australia, because we want people in Australia to buy the book too.
Right.
We've worked with clients that have all kinds of budgets. They generally range from, $5,000 to maybe, $10,000. But
that's great. Actually, that's exactly what I wanted to hear, because I think in some people's minds, something like this, they're looking at 30 to 50,000. And I see people who have, as we saw in the housing market and as we see in the stock market, it's not a sure thing. And if you're going to invest $8,000-$10,000 on something or spend it on 3 vacations, why not save up that money and invest in your own story? So $5,000 to $10,000, I know that sounds like a lot for someone who, $1,000 is a lot too. But if you think about it in perspective of, when you're thinking of saving or having some, that safety valve money, instead of investing it in something that is no longer a sure thing in the stock market, especially now, and even in real estate. So this is an investment in yourself. And I'm always looking for ways to have people invest in themselves. And your story is part of you. And as you said before, if it's presented in a way that it happened to you and this is how you grew and healed from it, what better way than to use that $8,000 you are saving to invest in yourself wisely, with someone like you who can hold hands and make sure you don't fall in the pitfalls that many who don't know and don't who know who to believe is. So I'm doing a commercial for you. How's that?
Thank you so much. And I do want to say that there are many excellent publishing consultants out there. There's a lot of them in the market. As self-publishing has grown, so have, people popping up, that are offering to teach you marketing and edit your book and do other services. I've not found another company that's just like ours, where we actually walk people through the entire thing, soup to nuts. We don't just put on webinars or, sell a package of services that are this or that. Ours is pretty comprehensive. So, as I mentioned, we'll start with people that are thinking of writing a book. Right. And help them to get the book written. We mentor them along through the process. We do the editing. We, help to get the book printed. We help them with crowdfunding. We do very, very comprehensive marketing. And we also offer storage and distribution, not just distribution from us and our own, accounts that we have, but we also have contracts with the major distributors in North America. So through our own contracts, people can avail themselves of those to get their book out there into the biggest catalogs and into the hands of the biggest distributors and into the biggest book chains. So, that is not something that I'm aware of other publishing consultants offering. There may be some, I just haven't run across them, but there are many, many excellent, consultants out there. I do want to, give my, colleagues a nod in that way, that I'm impressed by a lot of the services that are being offered out there, and think it's so important, because people can accidentally lose their life savings in self-publishing if they're not working with somebody that knows what they're doing. I would allow someone to spend too much money on a book that I think only has a warm chance in the marketplace, and we're very candid with people about that.
Yes, I can't wait for that when I have you read mine. but that's why I have you on too, because I don't just bring anyone on who wants to promote their products or service, but you definitely of all those that I've spoken with are one that really does care and has been at this long enough and knows the pitfalls. So thank you for that, Karen. And we're going to take a little break just for Two and Two to thank the sponsor of today's show. And we know who that is. So I'll be back in Two and Two. Peace in and peace out.
Do you have a book you want to publish? Do you need help finding a publisher? Are you confused by the self-publishing jungle? Then Karen Stuth, owner of Satyama Writers Resource and award-winning Satyama Publishing, is here to help. Whether it's design illustration, mentoring, editing, crowdfunding, production, marketing, or distribution, Satyama can help at affordable rates. Put your best writing foot forward and go to www.satyamawritersresource.com. That's www.satyamawritersresource.com. And welcome back. You are tuned in to my weekly talk radio show called Take My Advice. I'm Not Using It, Get Balance with Dr. Marissa. Every Tuesday at naturally high noon out of the Sunset Gower Studios with Universal Broadcasting Network. And then every Thursday at 7, Saturday at 1 on my syndicated CNBC News Radio channel, KCAA, AM 1050, FM 102.3, FM 106.5, and now everywhere on iHeartRadio. And today we have a very knowledgeable and very helpful resource for publishing. Karen Stuth from Satyama Publishing and Satyama Writers Resources here, and we've heard sort of the process and even a budget to be able to invest in your own story. I'm a little curious how you actually got started yourself. Did you write a book, or is it an area that interested you?
Well, I do plan to bring my own book out in the next 18 months. I need to stop working on everyone else's books. how we got started, my sister Susan and I together restarted a website called Satyama.com. Satyama, a word that we devised, and then later we found out that it was also the name of a huge stadium in Japan, so we were very excited about that. Because in both cases, you know, it's a place where people are intended to gather. So we loved that. But we started Satyama simply as a website that was meant to be a clearinghouse for all kinds of different spiritual ideas. You know, we just had a sort of a two-pronged test for putting anything on our website. And one is that it had to come from the heart. And the other was that it was not exclusionary, saying, you know, my way is the only way, or my thought is the only thought. So, you know, just using that as our yardstick, you know, we built a fairly large website. We have a meditation hall right on our website that you can visit and listen to meditations. And so that was our focus. And then I was approached by Dr. Stephen Farmer one day. We were talking about some other things, and literally Spirit stepped in, and I found myself saying the words, if you ever want to publish anything that other publishing houses seem not interested in, I hope you'll give us a call. And I myself had always been interested in the publishing world, you know, before I decided to stop practicing law. I was a lawyer, and publishing was one of the main areas that I was interested in.
There's the link.
You know, I've always had a fascination with that. I've always been an avid reader. So when Farmer, you know, came forward and said, well, you know, okay, what are you thinking of? And again, right out of my mouth fell the words, I think you should do something for children. And I remember that I was, you know, saying this to him and thinking, what are you doing?
Who's speaking?
Yes, who is speaking through my mouth? But I did undertake a printing project with him called Children's Spirit Animal Cards. And through, you know, printing and publishing those, I began to teach myself the publishing world. And then, you know, one title followed, and then another, and then another, and then another, and then another. And then we fell backwards by accident into children's books, because I was approached by the author of How the Trees Got Their Voices. And she was a person that I knew for a while and, you know, loved and respected, and of course still do. And she said, can I just read my children's book to you? And she read it to me, and I couldn't say any words when she finished reading it. I was so overwhelmed by the story and the beauty, because she also, you know, illustrated it herself. And I said, I'm going to send you a contract tomorrow to publish this book. And wow. The next thing I know, we're publishing. And I can't say enough about how much I love it, how I feel passionate about it. And it's the direction that our company was meant to go. Mm. So, you know, I feel led to this and extremely grateful beyond words because of that. There's not a day that goes by that the entire thing does not bring me just such immense joy. Mm. I cannot.
That's beautiful.
That's how it happened.
That is wonderful.
We have several top sellers in our category that, you know, I just, again, feel very grateful for that. But I think the most exciting thing about working in publishing is, of course, working with the authors and learning their story and reading what they've written. And it's just a magical experience to help them bring their voice forward in the world. I can't think that there would be anything better to do than this. Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm definitely hoping that you like my manuscript because I look forward to working with you. You're a direct answer. Because I have two. I have a children's book that I did self-publish, and I've sold over 5,000 copies, and I have one copy left. And before I send it out to a very expensive printer that I've been using named Staples, I want you to take a look at it because it's Mommy, What Are Feelings? And Every Feeling Has a Taste, Touch, Sight, and Sound. And it's been recognized by the autism community. So I can't wait for you to see that one, as well as my other advice book. But you're an answer to my own, you know, I just asked the question to a friendly universe. So who should I look at the book? And then boom. In Peru, it starts the whole process. And it's just wonderful. Any last words that you have? We're coming up at close to the end of the show. I usually ask you who you would like to thank for helping you along your journey to what you're doing now. So we'll start with that.
Well, gosh, there are so many people, but, you know, I certainly want to spirit of the universe for guiding me to being where I am today, and my sister for being an amazing business partner, and so many people along the way that have taught me or shown me or helped me, but most of all the authors, all of them, even people that we didn't end up working with, you know, just encountering them, reading their work. It's been very special and enriching. I feel my circle of gratitude is enormous.
That's beautiful.
We probably need another 20 minutes.
Okay, well, we don't have that. Any else that we didn't things that we didn't cover that you would like to bring forward? We covered quite a bit.
Just that, you know, no one should be afraid to sit down and start writing, you know, whatever comes to them, whether it's fiction, autobiographical. You know, everyone does have a fascinating story to tell, whether it's your own story or, you know, fictionalized something that happened to you or something you feel compelled to tell, that, you know, all those things are important to someone out there.
Yeah.
That, you know, someone wants to read that. And so don't be shy, you know, don't be afraid. Just, you know, start writing it down, and when you're ready, give us a call.
Super. And on that note, the Asian Oprah giveaway is a very generous 10 manuscript reviews from Karen, each worth value at $175. So if you have a manuscript ready, or if you have a couple of chapters ready, can I say that, Karen? If they even have just a couple of chapters ready that you would like Karen to review, I'm giving away 10 Asian Oprah giveaways today and Thursday and Saturday. So if you would contact me, and you can go to forbalance.org, and on the contact form, just put publishing, and the first 10 to do that will get
the 10 free manuscript reviews. So thank you, Karen, very much for that generous Asian Oprah giveaway. It's not a car, but we're working up to that. But it is beautiful, and I'm tempted to take two of those free for my own books right now. But we'll work something out. But thank you so much for being on the air with me. I am grateful that you do what you do, and you have such a passion in caring for it. And for that, I'm going to give you the Dr. Marissa Beneficial Presence on the Planet Award for helping people heal through writing their own experiences to share with the world. And I think that is pretty awesome. All right. Thanks, Karen.
Thank you so much.
I think Jarvis knows that you like the clapping. All right, and here we are at the end of the show, where I get to invite you to my balance bar. And that is a time where I get to spout off on all those things balance that I get to invite you to. And the first one, obviously, is the 21-day fast from complaining with Dr. Marissa. And those of you who've started on the day of inauguration, I know who you are, because you wanted some extra help not complaining. Congratulations. The official round 67 starts February the 1st, and we're doing a little something different now. In order to join the fast, you have to spend a whole 99 cents on either Google Play or Apple Store, and that will officially enter into the fast. And then I want you to use the link to Facebook to actually post your numbers. So we're holding people accountable to the number of times they're complaining. You can either compete with people around you, or you can compete with yourself to try to improve the score and not complain as much. And you all know, or those of you who don't, the app was created by teenagers. The promo itself that you can find on YouTube, just put Dr. Marissa an app, was created by my own teenager, and my little four-year-old great niece is on it. So you have to see it. And it is only 99 cents. And I will tell you that it is satisfaction guaranteed. If you do not like the daily tips that come on there, or the funny sounds that come out when you do complain or not complain, you get the cheer when you don't, or the videos that are attached, I will give you all of your money back. So please do join, get the app, and let me know how things are going, not complaining. If you do 21 days in a row, I'll know by what you post, and then I'll be able to give you an Asian Oprah giveaway, just like I did for Eva from Kentucky, Janina from Japan, and Daia from Long Beach. We need a guy to actually complete the fast, please. All right. And my Sedona retreat is coming up May 20 and 21st. And I'm telling about you about it now, because you can save $200 if you register right now. It's only $800 for the entire retreat, including two nights at either Los Abrigados or Sedona Summit or the Bell Rock Inn, which is amazing. That's like $500 right there. And just a little more for to contribute to my teaching that I also pass on to my peace work around the planet. So please do register on my website, drmarissa.tv, and go to Sedona Retreats. I also have a Facebook page that if I missed inviting you, please invite yourself to that, and I'll keep you updated, not just on Sedona, but other places that I'm teaching balance tools, including balance Tai Chi Gong, which is a combination of Tai Chi, Qigong, and new thought principles that I've learned. Dr. Michael Bernard Beckwith is one of my best teachers to ground you in belief in yourself, which is what I believe that all of you that I'm talking to right now are wrapped in a warm blanket of worthiness. You're loving, loved, and lovable. So please do join me at any of my talks or teachings. I get to also invite you to sign up at Agape. I'm teaching there March 4th and 11th, 10 to 2. So if you're in Culver City,
please, or anywhere near Culver City, please join me there. Also this Sunday, I'll be on stage again with the amazing Agape International Choir singing one of my favorite songs that you'll get to hear called I Was Here. Also, I am continuing to be a big loser on my own Facebook group called Feel Good and Look Good Naked with Dr. Marissa. And if you haven't already seen the free link, please watch the movie Fat, Sick and Nearly Dead, as well a new movie that I was given as homework by Dr. Lionel King, the movie Food Inc. It is really unbelievable the things that we don't know about what we're putting into our mouths. And so I am down 5 pounds and 7 inches. So I'm happy about that. If you would like to join the group, it's free. Please do go to Facebook and join me there. And thank you to Purple Planet Music for continuing to supply me with free fabulous music for my ads. And next week, I'm pleased to have Ryan Long, who is the host of City Gala, one of the big Oscar after party events, here to highlight some of the folks who use their star power for good. Richard Branson and James Cameron were the last two keynotes. And yes, I get to cover the event. Last year it was at the Howard Hughes. This year it's a little less racy. It's at the Disney Hall. So I'll be there and I'll be Facebooking live my interview. So please do tune in after the Oscars in a couple of weeks. So I will just continue to invite you to watch my past shows. If you missed the one with Muhammad Ali's daughter, Lila Ali, or Casey Kasem's daughter, Carrie Kasem, please do go to YouTube. Just Google Dr. Marissa and you'll be able to subscribe there for free and continuing to support the show about hope and happiness. And one last thank you to all of the staff that I get to work with. Fabulous Jarvis Essex, who is my sound engineer at UBN. Tony Sweet, the owner. Fred Lundgren over at KCAA. Mark Westwood, Carlos, and the organic Mike Lundgren. Thank you so much for continuing to support my show. Xinyan Kuaile, Happy Chinese New Year to all, and especially my listeners who've made this show win so many awards, and I'm so grateful for the continuing increase. I increased over 20,000 in views in YouTube in just the last week, so what can I say? Hope and happiness is trending. That's it for now. Keep it tuned to Take My Advice. I'm not using it. Get balanced with Dr. Marissa Pay. That's P for positive, EI. And remember, it's all about balance. Peace in and peace out.
At an early age, people around me, my heart in a cage. Life was a book, don't turn a page. I couldn't see past my rage. I wanted to dance, but I pushed you away. Now I'm on my knees, I'll listen to what you say. And you said